Okay, so let me kick things off here officially then by welcoming folks to the 2022 Summer Institute for Equity in the Academic Experience. I'm Heidi Elmendorf. I'm the director of the Hub for Equity and Innovation in Higher Education at Georgetown. And I'm also an associate professor in the biology department. I'm joined today, and they'll introduce themselves, by Susanna McGowan and my colleague Randy Bass. The three of us, along with Dr. Adna Johnson, who's also joining us here this morning, kind of formed the core of the Georgetown leadership team for this institute. This is our third institute. Our first one was here on the Georgetown campus and was pretty small scaled. The pandemic year ate us all alive in 2020. Last year, we held an entirely virtual conference in deference to the pandemic. And this year, as you all know, we're launching a hybrid version of this institute. And we're excited to both be able to convene nationally again, but also to gather more locally. And we're excited here at Georgetown. We've got the Georgetown team downstairs from where I'm sitting right now, and they've been working together all morning. So we're excited by this new version, and we hope that what we're sharing this year is a really sustainable model for this sort of a gathering in the future. I want to begin with an acknowledgement that we come and we gather here today as the result of many inequities. So I begin today with kind of the somber acknowledgement that Georgetown University and its Washington, D.C. campuses inhabit traditional and ever ceded Piscataway territory and the Nacotchtank territory. And we want to be mindful of the histories and the people who made our gathering here possible today. I also want to acknowledge that Georgetown has a very particular history, and our presence here today is enabled by the proceeds of an 1838 sale of 314 enslaved women, children, and men. Their stolen labor and displacement undergirds our gathering. And this is something that we inherit as individuals who elect to be part of the Georgetown community today. My job in kicking things off this morning is pretty brief, and it's really a series of thank yous. I first want to thank the American Talent Initiative, specifically Bloomberg Philanthropies and the Gray Foundation for their support. It's their financial generosity that's made this institute possible, and possible free of charge for all participants. I also want to acknowledge what we've taken to calling the Equity Institute Squad. So there are three units at Georgetown that have come together to pull this off: the Hub for Equity and Innovation in Higher Education, the Red House, and the Office of Student Equity and Inclusion. And again, you'll hear from a handful of us this morning as we kick off the Institute. I also want to acknowledge that this is the second year of a partnership at the Institute for Xavier University of Louisiana, in particular for Dr. Richard Peters from Xavier. And again, our colleagues from the American Talent Initiative, none of this would have been possible without year-long conversations and the community of practice that they helped to establish. And so a special shout out to Sunny Hong and Emily Schwartz. I also want to say this year that what's really made this possible is this broad leadership group. So we decided on a model by which we would share responsibility with a number of other schools. And we intentionally invited to join us schools who have a strong commitment to this work, but also who represent a breadth of the higher education ecosystem. So we're really grateful for the partnership of Nuray Gray from Claremont McKenna College, Bethany Usher and Shelley Reed from George Mason University, Meg Daly from Ohio State University, Roderick Lee from Penn State University Harrisburg, Aretha Watson from Rutgers University, Anna Flaming, Mira Anson, and then Christy Norris from the University of Ohio, Mary Wardell Giriduzzi and Maytag Yang from the University of the Pacific, and April Bellback from the University of Pittsburgh. And I'd be remiss if I didn't give a special shout out at this moment to Dr. Roderick Lee. Roderick, hope you're out there somewhere in this screen that I can't really see. Penn State University is a model of institution for what it looks like to show up in force. There is, I believe, every campus in the Penn State system and their broader Commonwealth of campuses represented. And that substantial investment in this work and in the Institute is really the work of Dr. Roderick Lee. So Roderick, We're always grateful for this partnership. Today is also made possible by all of you. And so we come together as a group of 59 different teams from 44 colleges and universities, representing 2 and 4 year schools from across the country. There's about 425 attendees and another 50 or so folks who are joining us as speakers and coaches and support staff. We have a total of 55 speakers giving 3 provocations, one happening in just a minute, 6 roundtables and 9 workshops. And there's a total of 20 coaches who are available for you to sign up for office hours for consultation sessions. I'm going to turn the microphone now over to continue the introduction to my colleague, Dr. Randy Bass.
Thank you, Heidi, and welcome to all of you. It's just so amazing to watch all of your numbers and your weighing in and your checking in just appearing in the chat. I'm a vice president here at Georgetown, vice president for strategic education and leader of the Red House. And I wanted to just take a moment. We wanted to just draw attention to the values that we hope that we'll bring to the Institute. We aspire to model here the kind of climate that we want to be the norm in every classroom and on every campus. So to help us bring us together and create a professional, equitable, and collaborative community, we offer just a few norms and guidelines for the Institute over the next 3 days. We ask that you participate in ways that are relentlessly welcoming to each other, respectfully inclusive, and avidly participatory. We know that this is the spirit that you all bring to this work. And speaking of this work, the work we are all doing here at the Institute this week is all about connections. We want to help your campus team connect your project to a specific equity issue that will serve as a high leverage opportunity for your progress, connect your project to the strategic equity goals of your institution, to connect to similar work happening in other parts of your institution across silos, and to connect to the broader higher education equity ecosystem, including institutions with common geographic or project interests. So the overall design of the Institute, the sessions, the team time, the coaching, the final feedback session on Wednesday, they're all designed to help foster these connections and especially to support our motto for the Institute, which is come with a goal and leave with a plan. So we want to support you in that. And with that, I'll turn it back to Susanna.
Thank you, Randy. Good morning and welcome, everyone. My name is Susanna McGowan. I'm the Director for Curriculum Transformation Initiatives at the Red House at Georgetown University. We're so glad that you're here. And I'm going to explain a couple of concrete items that we just want to point your attention towards. And part of the maintaining connections and fostering connections at this year's Institute is our belief in the idea of peer-to-peer conversations are what really drive change and institutional change. And so what we've built into the Institute this year is a focus on having a fantastic, phenomenal cohort of coaches who are providing their time and expertise and knowledge to our teams this year. And so I'm going to drop in the chat a link to the coaching cohort that's in our Sketch platform. And I love that in the URL, it says that they're artists and they truly are. So they're available that where you can sign up to meet with individual coaches. I'm also dropping the sign up form in the chat as well. Also in the spirit of developing relationships and collegial conversations, on Wednesday, we're ending the Institute with just that. And we have a feedback session which is very low stakes, very collegial conversations so we can share our plans with each other and get feedback from each other before the Institute ends. We will be providing more information about that tomorrow morning, so stay tuned for that email. And finally, we have a platform called Sketch, which holds our schedule. And in this platform, you can find what's ahead, and the Zoom links are available in the session 10 minutes before the start of the session. So everything should be contained in there. We're also using this as our communication platform. So you will receive emails from Sketch through via us. So I just wanted to alert you to that as well. And now I'm going to introduce my colleague, Dr. Adna Johnson, who is our partner in planning the Institute, who is the head of our Georgetown's Office for Student Equity and Inclusion. She's Associate Vice President at Georgetown, and she will introduce our first speaker, Dr. Timothy Eatman. I'll pass it over to you, Dr. Johnson.
Thank you, Susanna, and good day, no matter where you are, if it's afternoon or morning. Early morning for our California folks. Welcome to the Institute, and I'm grateful for my colleagues for all the work that they've done, everyone at the Hub, the Red House, and my colleagues at OSEI. I have the pleasure of introducing our esteemed provocation speaker for this morning, Dr. Timothy K. Eatman. Dr. Eatman is the inaugural dean of the Honors Living Learning Community at Rutgers University Newark, a community at the intersection of equity, inclusion, and belonging. He is also an associate professor in the Department of Urban Education at Rutgers University Newark. Most recently, he held an appointment as associate professor of higher education in the School of Education at Syracuse University. From 2012 to 2017, Dr. Eatman served as faculty co-director of Imagining America, Artists and Scholars in Public Life, IA. He is co-author of Scholarship in Public, Knowledge Creation and Tenure Policy in the Engaged University, a seminal research report on faculty rewards and publicly engaged scholarship. He serves in national roles, including as faculty member for the Association of American Colleges and Universities, Summer Institutes on High Impact Practices, and the advisory panel for the Carnegie Engagement Classification for Community Engagement. Most recently, his HLLC efforts were featured in the book Relationship Rich Education, co-authored by Peter Felton and Leo Lambert, where he was quoted as saying, quote, "Any student who is able to develop healthy and inspiring relationships with faculty or other folks on campus will thrive," end quote. His ethos led us here today in our first provocation, Beware the Shrinking Imagination. We're so grateful for you, Dr. Eatman, and thank you for your time.
Dr. Johnson, thank you so much for that very warm and kind introduction. I am very honored by your words and honored to be here. I am just kind of stunned that I've literally been invited to provoke you, right? It's like for joy, you know? I'm just about as excited as I was a few years ago when I got invited to an institution where a team of four of us were called in as academic stylists. We were charged to provide feedback with publicly engaged scholars, solid in their discipline, but in need of what they called some accessorizing, you know, with the engagements of and the methodologies of publicly engaged scholarship. So it's a really kind invitation, and it's tough to do in a short amount of time, but I'm glad to have the opportunity. And Randy knows I'm a bit unorthodox, so if it's too much for you, just blame him, okay? So as I understand it, this is the first provocation of the Institute, following on the heels of some strategic conversations about goal setting and contextualizing your projects in your campus equity strategy. What if I told you that I didn't believe in equity? That I think it really doesn't matter. Most especially not racial equity in higher education. What if I told you that? Well, you'd probably think, well, what is he doing here, right? Randy would likely gather colleagues from networks that we are working and building in together, like bringing theory to practice, and plan an intervention for Tim Eatman, right? Because I had lost my damn mind, and he would be correct. Now, of course, I do believe in equity and the promise that higher education has to expand it in service of healing our society with every fiber in my being. But I also find myself very often navigating this idea of a shrinking imagination. What about you? My simple thesis is that those of us who work for equity and social change in higher education are quite a bit more vulnerable to a special kind of limited thinking than we might think we are. So what can we do about this? In this vein, I've titled this provocation, Beware the Shrinking Imagination. I'm so delighted that we started in the way that we should with acknowledgments. And I have an abiding sense that if I'm walking in my vocation, as I should, people around me can sense the regal aura of my ancestors upon me. The same is true for the beautiful First Nations people whose land we hold space today in the myriad ways that have been named. I would that you could catch a sweet whiff of Lenape or Onondaga, as I am frequently between Manhattan and Central New York. If you do not, please be patient with me. I desire to honor them and the responsibilities of being in those spaces in every way I can, as I know you do. And I'm still working through the masks of my colonial education, the masks that my colonial education has imposed. I am gonna take a second here because it looks like my slides are not advancing. So I need to just, if you give me a second, reset this here. Sorry about that. Okay. I am so sorry. Okay. This happens. Come on. Ah, darn it. This really is troubling. I am so sorry. Thanks for your patience.
Not a problem. You're doing well.
Yeah, darn it. I'm using Sidecar with my laptop, and sometimes it cuts out. I don't know why, but it has done that, but I think I'm back now. Okay. All right. Yes. So I was just acknowledging the ancestors, grateful for that, and realizing that, we cannot beware of the things that we need to be tuned into if we're not knowledgeable and honoring of what has gone before us. So this is a working hybrid institute. I know how these things go. You know, I've been involved with institutes of a similar fashion. I love the great format and the teams. It's project focused. You all even have a time zone coordination thing going here. I don't know what that's really about, but I think it makes sense. It would be great to be in person with you, but we know about the challenges we are still facing with the pandemic. But even in this video conference heavy time, there are approaches that we can use to get to know each other. So I'm going to ask you quickly just to humor me. If you would, pull out your phone or go to another web browser and just go to slido.com. I got three quick polls I want to get you in on, if you don't mind. Three quick polls, slido.com. And SHIM is what I'd like you to log into for shrinking imagination, SHIM. And you should be able to see a poll. So we'll just take a quick minute, and I see folks are getting in on it right now.
Take your time.
We'll just on your spend a few minutes gathering this information, getting you involved. Staff and administrators, we have some faculty admin. One innocent bystander, that's cool.
You can be free, lifted, take you where you wanna go. A pursuit of happiness.
Nice. 182 participants. Thank you for humoring me here. All right, we're going to go to a second one. What do you call your primary discipline or area of scholarship? Remember, I don't have a lot of time, so you got to get in there quickly. Student success. Okay. Awesome. I got to move on. Keep it going, though. I've got one more that I want to go to. Share a word that comes to mind when you think about the notion of shrinking imagination. Yikes. That's awesome. All right. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate you jumping in there on this with me. And I'm excited about the things that you were able to share and wish we had time to unpack it. However, we really don't. I want to just celebrate the thematic priorities of this institute, expanding the ecosystem, mapping strategic progress, integrating campus conversations, and just noting that none of this is achievable with the pervasive mindset that dominates the ivory tower. What is that? Oh no, the psychometric rigor of our research is on point. The depth of critique is awe-inspiring. Look how smart you are. Congratulations on the grant you got. But always somewhere in the cut looms this phenomenon I call the shrinking imagination. So what is this thing, Dr. Eatman? In short, I believe shrinking imagination is rooted in the conscious or unconscious awareness of lack. It is an illumination of the pervasive scarcity of purpose. It shows up epistemologically, ontologically, as well as ethically. It's like marking time in the work we do, our deep commitment seemingly to maintaining the status quo. It's a lack of effrontery. It shows up in blind, radical change efforts that don't have strategy. It's a lack of true introspection. It's not a deficit in knowledge per se, but it works against the practice of full participation. I think it is a non-awareness of the importance of publicly engaged scholarship in our work. You know what I mean by publicly engaged scholarship, academic work that is scholarly or creative, and it's integral to a faculty member's academic area, encompassing different forms of knowledge about, for, and with diverse publics and communities. Coherent, purposeful sequence of activities contributing to the public good and yielding artifacts of public and intellectual value. I want us to think about the importance of community engaged or publicly engaged scholarship as one of the things that can trigger us in our work to beware the shrinking imagination, which is all around us, in the society, on campus, in so many different ways. We are troubled by this notion of shrinking imagination. I am going to keep pushing forward, but my slides have failed me again, so I'll get them up if I can. But I'm going to keep moving forward here. So I wonder if we're in a position of confronting the notion of shrinking imagination, then we can really face some of the questions that we find are so prevalent in our academic experience about the idea of challenges of the university that that we find ourselves asking questions about the decline of the university, the idea of institutions of higher education that are in crisis. We know that these crises face us in a bunch of ways, but I want us to ask a different kind of question, which is what kind of institutions of higher education does a strong democracy need? I think these are the kinds of questions that challenge us outside of this shrinking imagination. What kinds of institutions of higher education does a strong democracy need? My favorite human and poet, Langston Hughes, challenges us to be in that prophetic imagining space with this great poem. He says, "I dream a world where man, no other man, was born. Where love will bless the earth and peace its path is drawn. I dream a world where all will know sweet freedom's way. Where greed no longer saps the soul, nor avarice fights tyranny. This is a world I dream where black or white, whatever race you be, share the bounties of the earth, and every man is free. With wretchedness behind it said, and joy like a pearl, defends the needs of all mankind. Of such I dream." I don't know about you, but as I try to navigate my shrinking imagination, I really lean on the power of the humanities and the arts. Colleagues, let's not forget about the power, the methodology, the strategies out of the humanities and the arts as we're going about this equity work, this cultural change work at our institutions. One of the most delicious things that I was able to do with my colleagues at Imagining America before we handed the reins over to the new great administration was to develop a book called What is the Work of Imagining? I don't have time to talk through it now, but it was developed around images and metaphors and stories. And we worked as a team to produce it around seven moves, the work of imagining. We worked with partners from the ASHE Arts and Culture Organization in New Orleans. We hired them as our poet mentors to help us get out of our academies, to confront our shrinking imagination, to think about the importance of letting both hands go like children do, right? In terms of getting their imagination in gear. Oh man, I am telling you, this thing is gonna make me say something that I don't wanna say. Oh boy, colleagues, I appreciate your patience. I am struggling here. This work of imagining book, I think the screen is back up, no? Is it not?
Now it is, yes.
Okay, this work of imagining is around not only letting both hands go, but doing the rigorous work of developing your art and science, what we call conjugating freedom, right? We know that that lies in the face sometimes or flies in the face of letting both hands go as children do. But beware of a shrinking imagination that we've been talking about and thinking about the importance of taking breaking points and making them into making points, being intentional about creating spaces and cultivating and sustaining those spaces and inviting boundless infinities. I want to challenge you, colleagues, as you go through this time together in the Institute, to identify three things that lead you to shrinking imagination. Perhaps that is not your challenge, but perhaps it is. Actually, I want to ask you, if you are in the chat, to think about ways in which you find yourself with a shrinking imagination and put a word, a name, or something that represents that in front of your name, just as we wind down this conversation. As you think about the challenge of shrinking imagination, is there a name that comes to mind? Is there a concept? Is there a word? It might be a word that you put in the Slido. It's the kind of thing that gets us away from the principles that we'd find in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights around the importance of the cultural life to the community. In my introduction, Dr. Johnson mentioned the work with Imagining America. And I really am so indebted to that community for helping me think about how to maintain a prophetic imagination by connecting hearts and spirits with minds, recognizing that the challenges that we face in academe are serious. Here's a doctoral student says, I'm working on a dissertation in modernist literature and American philosophy and teaching worlds like classes like Love in the World Literature and American Identity in the World. I know that such classes, as well as my own project, speak to all of us on a human level, but increasingly I find the university is no place for humanity. Shrinking imagination. I will not be able to have time to go through some of the scholarship and conceptual models that we've developed that challenge this idea of shrinking imagination, but I point you to the Imagining America resource and our work on scholarship in public, faculty rewards research that looks at the importance of humanities and arts in the promotion and tenure system. I challenge you to think about some of the work that we've done on full participation and how that lends itself to a notion of prophetic imagination. I don't have time. I know that I'm probably provoking you by going through these slides so quickly, but I'm at the end of my time, really. And I want to just challenge you to think about the importance of these mechanisms that we have in higher education, like the Carnegie Engagement Classification, to help us get to a prophetic imagination and be aware of our shrinking imagination. I'm running through some slides here about my own Honors Living Learning community. It's our imagination project at Rutgers Newark. Hopefully you can come visit us in our new building at some point and to sit with our students who are working on a minor in social justice, even as they're doing their major in our new building. And as I wind down, I want to challenge you to take with you what I call five critical senses of engagement. I map them to a hand. Hope is the thumb. History is the pointer finger. Passion is the tall finger. Empathy is the ring finger. And the pinky is planning. If we're going to really wrangle with this shrinking imagination, we got to begin with hope. Why? Hope lets us grab onto something. Yeah? I don't know about you, but in these hope challenge times, I need to grab onto something. I need to get together with Randy and say, man, what's making you hopeful, brother? How are we working through this stuff? That opposable thumb lets us grab onto it. The finger of history, that pointer finger, lets us point back to the past and then to the present, but also to the future. It helps us keep that kind of context. It gives us the humility that was spoken about in the land acknowledgement. Oh my goodness. I am just totally going to stop because this thing is frozen again, and that's okay. The tall finger is the sense of passion. It's like oil in the engine of hope, right? The older I get, I know passion is short-lived. You gotta have more than passion. You gotta have empathy. That ring finger is the sense of empathy. Publicly engaged scholarship sense that I think we need to bring to bear to mitigate shrinking imagination. And last of all, the pinky of planning reminds us how important it is for us to bring to bear the kind of strategy and intentionality that will get us to a place of prophetic imagination. Hope, history, passion, empathy, reminding us that how we have skin in the game together, and passion. I thank you for your time. I appreciate your patience with my technology. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. So thank you so much, colleagues. Hello? Am I being heard?
You're good.
You are. Thank you, Tim. Sorry, the chat is bubbling up with enthusiasm.
I can't see it. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, lots of love and appreciation in the chat, Tim. No worries.
Thank you.
Will your slides be available to the general public?
I can send the team the Prezi. Again, it worked in practice. So I don't know what happened. I don't know, Randy, are we gonna Is there any comments or questions, or I don't know?
Yeah, there's some questions in the chat. Let me just start with one.
Yeah, can somebody help me out?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think we were just, for those of us who are watching the chat, we're just letting the chat scroll a little bit and letting the chat speak. Just feeling the energy coming up from the community. I think that's why the pause there. So, one question I think maybe just to ask is where on campus, on campuses or on your campus, where do you feel that there are the spaces to help stakeholders and people who care about this work enlarge their imagination or expand it? How does the community support that?
Beautiful, beautiful question about spaces. One of the moves in the work, what is the work of imagination, a book that we created, centers on this notion of creation of spaces. And I think we have to be as intentional as we humanly can be about what it means to create spaces. One of my favorite spaces, and Randy, you may know this, Rutgers University Newark has the largest jazz research archive in the world. And it has a jazz club. And what we have moved to do with my HLLC Honors Living Learning Community Scholars is to conduct what they advised me is not a performance, but a flow. And so several times a semester around themes, it might be education or water, healthcare or whatever, the students come together with spoken word and music and movement, right? And it's those partnerships with community folks who are also performing and sharing those sorts of things. And so that's one of the kinds of spaces, Randy, that at least at Rutgers Newark is, an example to me of the kinds of gathering spaces. The other thing I'll just say quickly is that we lease about 50,000 square feet across the street at a place where we call it Express Newark. We don't own it, we lease it. It's got an amazing story. I can't go into it now, but it's an example of a public-private partnership with the city and developers and Rutgers not taking over, but being a part of that space. Express Newark has a portrait studio. It has an incubator space that is used by entities on a 2 or 3 year period. It's got computer labs and places where movie screenings are held and a 3D computing lab and our visual means. Anyway, so those are two of the spaces, at least at Rutgers Newark, that really are intentionally created for the gathering of campus and community together. I'm sorry if I've rambled on that.
No, that's fantastic. Thank you so much. We have another question in the chat from Leanne Wells at Florida International University. And she writes, the requirements for faculty to do more and more administrative work has got to be a part of the shrinking imagination.
Right.
How can faculty nurture their imagination and creativity in the onslaught of administrivia?
Yeah, this is a big question, but I'm gonna be provoking a bit more. Faculty have the most power on campus, especially tenured faculty. What's with all of these? Come on. I mean, did the tenure process beat everything out of you? I mean, really? Like, administrators come and go, students come and go. Like, the citizenry of the academy is the faculty. Like, don't be a punk, right? Like, do what the community organizers do if you want to really, manage that kind of thing. Somebody said, amen. I did see that chat. Like, come on, we got power, right? Let us not succumb to the tradition of sameness. That's why we have to, create different kinds of spaces. Like, right, the humanists will tell you, if you have a policy meeting about faculty rewards after you have a story circle, you have a different kind of policy meeting. right? Because you've heard the stories, right? You understand what these, for example, sisters of childbearing age are navigating as they go through the faculty rewards process. I'm going to stop there, but this is a really good question, and I want to turn it back on us in terms of our own sense of agency as faculty. I hope that's helpful.
Extremely helpful. And I'm going to move to another part, really important part of the university, and thinking about our students and how can, question for the University of Iowa, how can students act as collaborators in this endeavor with us?
Yeah. Well, again, you know, we got to see them as collaborators, right? I mean, you know, we, one of the things I've been telling my students kind of routinely is, you know what? My respect to you. You are tough. Which one of us could have gone to Zoom University? I know. I see some nods. I couldn't have done it, right? They would have put me out so quick. But the resilience that they demonstrate, right? Like letting them know I'm learning stuff from you, right? Some of my highest GPA are my undocumented students, right? One of the beautiful things about the HLLC is that, you know, we're not afraid of sort of what we call intergenerational grouping, right? So I have 60-year-olds and 17-year-olds, right? Who I take seriously, right? Who I'm listening, but tell me about your, we have folks that are system impacted, that some serve time in jail. Now, no one who's on a sexual offender list can be in the residence hall. You get that. But my point is, you know, there's a lot of knowledges that we can, if we take them seriously, if we communicate to them that we do take them seriously, and we're thinking how important it is for us to learn from them, learn from their resilience. How would you navigate not knowing if your mother's going to be home the next time you go because you're undocumented? Could you study and focus and get the top grades? I'll stop there.
Thank you so much. And I think it connects to our next question from Penn State about sharing examples of restoring the imagination. And I think that's a really good one, is being so impressed with our students and what they're able to accomplish given all of what they're dealing with, whether it's online or in person or wherever they are, just meeting them where they are. I think that's a great example. But what are some other examples of restoring the imagination that come to mind for you?
Yeah, I mean, I'm just thinking about the networks that we've developed, the associations, the institutes like this, like that's what this is about, right? I mean, you know, Randy and I are connected in several, you know, different entities that are working on higher ed change. And, you know, I think you'll agree with me. We've been intentional about how we open our meetings, right? Checking in with each other. How are you, brother? Like, you know, right? It's like, you know, what are the intentions that you bring to the space, right? Like, you know, not that you're smothering somebody, you want to be in their house all the time, but do you really see me? Do you really hear me? Right. And like being, you know, intentional about creating the kinds of spaces that put us, you know, as colleagues, not only with students, but from one to each other in that space where spirits and hearts meet minds. I know, you know, faculty, when you say spirit and heart, they get turned off. I get that. I don't care. Right. What I'm saying is, I'm a sociologist. For the kind of cultural change we need cultural practices. Right. And those are around the relational dynamics that were aforementioned as this session opened. Here's to spirit and heart. All right. I think I even see a heart emoji. I don't always know how to make those reactions, but.
We have another question. We have a couple of questions. We're not going to be able to get to all of them, but they're all centered on hope and inclusive culture and thinking about faculty, staff, and students and administration. A question from Terry Lee Watson is, what advice do you have when hope seems to be lost, and how can we replenish it?
Yeah, I mean, I face that all the time, you know. And, you know, people handle it different ways. Since you asked me, I'm going to tell you that for me, my faith practice is important. And I'm not going into the details of it. You can catch me offline if you want to talk about that. But for me, it's the kind of thing that drives me to my networks, to my colleagues, right? To seek out ways of realizing what the realities are in front of us, but using that sense of hope, that opposable thumb that can let me grab onto something, right? People do that in different ways, and I get that. But for me, that sense of imagination and hope is deeply rooted in my faith practice, right? You know, it's one thing I think we need to do is like give people a lot of grace, because there's a lot of trauma. I mean, we're seeing that in ways that we never saw before. I can almost not speak as a parent when I think about Uvalde, and you know, I was in a Tops grocery store the other day because there's one in the region where I live, and I'm by the chicken, and I'm like, am I gonna get shot here? Like, I mean, you know, my wife says, Tim, don't be dramatic. I'm not trying to be dramatic. I'm like just saying, like, am I gonna get killed? Right? And so that's pretty damn depressing, right? Not to mention the homophobia and the Asian hate and this anti-Semitism. I mean, shrinking imagination. And so, listen, I got me an automatic weapon. Yeah, I got me one. Okay, but you know what it's shooting? It's shooting love. You got me? Yeah, I want to slay every one of you. Ha! Right? I am coming in with guns blazing like I'm on a battlefield, but it's not in that love cannon, Richard said. Yeah, that's where I'm coming from, right? And I will not, I'm going to stop. Go ahead. I'm going to stop. You got my blood pressure up.
Same. I think we're ready to go on that metaphor. We can't thank you enough, Tim, Dr. Eatman. We really appreciate your time and getting us off to a fantastic start for the Institute. I'm gonna share my screen to show you what sessions are up next, and then we're all gonna take a break and replenish ourselves before we go into the next sessions. So the next sessions that are starting in 7 minutes, we have 3 roundtables that are coming up that explore equity in admissions, leadership, as well as efforts on campuses to interpret and disseminate the results of campus climate surveys. And then the afternoon workshops, following a short break, the afternoon workshops. We have 3 fantastic workshops on high impact practices and equity, integrating inclusive pedagogy in our university systems, as well as more data focused workshops from the Penn State team. So with that, we're going to take a break and thank Dr. Eatman again for his fantastic words and wonderful visuals. And we just appreciate your time so much and your words and your spirit.